Scientists that study at Yellowstone are interested in locating physical and chemical signals from the deep magmatic system. This is done for the dual purpose of better comprehending the nature of the system and keeping an eye out for any potential shifts. Well, the highly alarming thing is that the scientists had detected abnormally high levels of helium-4 gas at the Yellowstone Supervolcano, a sign that an eruption could be imminent. The thought of a massive volcanic eruption was enough to send shivers down my spine. Let's look down at the matter, which has been circulating. The historical volcanic eruptions that have a place in Yellowstone National Park were catastrophic events that affected the entire world. Today, scientists are attempting to determine whether or not this ticking time bomb will detonate or whether it will simply fizzle away. Throughout the past 2.1 million years, Yellowstone National Park has been the site of three cycles of explosive volcanism, and the rock outcrops and other landforms in the surrounding area provide traces of these events. The geysers, hot springs, and patches of steaming earth that are a feature of Yellowstone's current hydrothermal systems are evidence of Yellowstone's volcanic origin, despite the fact that there have been no magmatic eruptions in Yellowstone for the past 70,000 years. These features are evidence that can be seen that a significant quantity of heat is stored deep into the subsoil. Scientists that study at Yellowstone are interested in locating physical and chemical signals from the deep magmatic system. This is done for the dual purpose of better comprehending the nature of the system and keeping an eye out for any potential shifts. The portion of this research includes the collecting and examination of gas and water from thermal zones in order to hunt for chemical tracers that can be directly connected to the magma. Helium is a non-reactive gas that is very good at tracing the activities that occur within magma. There are two important isotopes of helium: helium-3, which is stored deep in the Earth's mantle, where it was trapped during the formation of the Earth, and helium-4, which is produced during the radioactive decay of uranium and thorium, two elements that are commonly found in the Earth's crust. Helium-3 is stored deep in the Earth's mantle, where it was trapped during the formation of the Earth. At the surface of the Earth, helium-3 is extremely uncommon. For example, the ratio of helium-3 and 4 in the air is 1.4 by 10 to 6, which equates to around 1 helium-3 for every million helium-4 atoms. On the other hand, some of the helium-3 that was trapped in the mantle make its way to the surface as magma rises from below. When we talk about the ratios in different gas samples, we often refer to something called the air ratio as our comparison standard. If gas has been held for a long time in the Earth's crust, it is likely to contain very high concentrations of helium-4 in comparison to helium-3, and the helium-3-4 ratio will be low, giving the gas a lower RA value. This is because helium-4 has a shorter half-life than helium-3. In contrast, a petrol sample obtained from a volcano that is actively erupting will most likely have a higher proportion of helium-3 to helium-4, meaning that the ratio will be high and the RA value will be greater. In the interest of brevity and clarity, we will refer to the RA value of air as 1. Numbers that are significantly higher than 1 suggest that there is a much higher proportion of helium-3, more mantle component, than what is found in the air. To put it another way, if the RA value is high, it indicates that the petrol came from magma. If the RA is low, this indicates that there is no magmatic source. Yellowstone's thermal zones have been studied for years, and those studies have proven that gas in numerous of those locations is strongly linked to the magmatic system. The helium-3-helium-4 ratio of gas emitted from a fumarole at Mud Geyser in the Mud Volcano thermal area is the greatest of any feature at Yellowstone, reaching up to 17 RA. Moreover, nearby thermal zones have degassing structures with RA values that are greater than 15. Similarly, the helium-3-4 ratios in petrol from various features in the Gibbon Geyser Basin, which is located on the rim of Yellowstone's caldera, are similarly extremely high. However, the maximum RA value in this region is -12.6. Both of these thermal areas have waters that have a tendency to be acidic and have high concentrations of sulfur. Additionally, both of these thermal areas have superheated fumaroles, which are areas where the temperature of the gas emerging from the ground is higher than the temperature of the water that is boiling. Gas that is located beyond the caldera boundary has also been discovered to contain relatively high RA levels. The thermal zones at Mammoth Hot Springs, which are located in the north of the park, and Boundary Creek, which are located in the southwest corner of the park, are very different from the area surrounding Mud Volcano. the temperatures of the thermal features do not go higher than the boiling point, and the pH of the hot springs is rather close to being neutral. There is a robust signal coming from the magmatic system, despite the fact that these regions are often cooler and are located at a greater distance from the primary flow of magmatic gas. In general, the RA values of thermal zones near Yellowstone Lake and other thermal features in the southeast section of the park are not particularly high, less than 5. These low ratios suggest that there is a greater amount of helium-4, which is the isotope of the gas that is stored in the rocks that make up the crust. The Yellowstone magma system is responsible for the heating that has enabled enormous quantities of this form of helium to be released from the crust. Nevertheless, the magma itself is not the source of this gas, it comes from the crust. Isotopes are important to consider, even though helium is an excellent indicator of magmatic activity beneath the surface. If you know whether the gas is helium-3 or helium-4, you can figure out where it came from. It may have come from the mantle and been brought to the surface by lava, or it could have come from crustal rocks that are billions of years old and have been generated by the process of radioactive decay. As Yellowstone contains both stable and radioactive isotopes of helium, determining the relative abundance of the two forms of this element is essential to comprehend its origin. One of the world's most significant volcanoes lies dormant beneath Yellowstone National Park, a massive area consisting of breathtaking wildness that is explored by approximately 3 million people on an annual basis. The Yellowstone caldera, which is the cauldron-like basin at the summit of the volcano, is so enormous that it is commonly referred to as a supervolcano. This, according to the Natural History Museum in London, indicates that the Yellowstone caldera has the potential to produce an eruption of magnitude 8 on the volcanic explosivity index, discharging more than 1,000 cubic kilometers of material. To put that into perspective, the eruption of Pinatubo in the Philippines in 1991, which is arguably the most powerful volcanic eruption in living memory, was rated at 6 on the volcanic explosivity index. This means that it was around 100 times smaller than the benchmark for a supervolcano, as stated by the Natural History Museum. Should we therefore be concerned? Will Yellowstone have an eruption in the near future? Are we overdue for an eruption in Yellowstone? There have been numerous claims made by the media that Yellowstone is on the verge of erupting. They assert that the impending eruption of the supervolcano is inevitable due to the fact that its most recent eruption occurred 70,000 years ago. Yet, that's not how volcanoes usually behave at all. This is possibly the most widespread misperception about Yellowstone and about volcanoes in general, the author writes. Michael Poland, a geophysicist and the scientist in charge of Yellowstone Volcano Observatory, told Live Science in an email that volcanoes do not work on timelines. They erupt when there is enough eruptive magma beneath the surface and pressure to cause that magma to ascend, says one expert. They erupt when there is pressure to drive that magma to climb. Neither circumstance is present at Yellowstone at the present time, he went on to say. It all comes down to the availability of the magma. If you cut off that supply, the volcano won't explode. According to Poland, many volcanoes go through alternating periods of activity and dormancy. Most of the time, the activity of a volcano is a direct result of the supply of magma that it has available. Kilauea in Hawaii and Stromboli in Italy are two examples of volcanoes where the supply of magma is very stable, according to Poland. Some volcanoes do appear to have regular eruptions, he said. The concept that Yellowstone is due for an eruption has been around for a while, but where did it originate? According to Poland, I assume that the term delayed originates from the concept of earthquakes. Earthquakes occur when stress builds up on faults, and in many areas that tension builds up at pretty steady rates due to, for example, plate motion. This can cause earthquakes to occur. Given this information, it is reasonable to anticipate that earthquakes will happen at intervals that are reasonably consistent with one another. It is more complicated than that, of course, because there are numerous elements at play. Nonetheless, because of this, it makes more sense to argue that a fault is overdue for an earthquake. Poland also mentioned that supervolcanoes, a phrase he considers to be fairly crass and sensationalist, are neither more nor less temperamental than regular volcanoes. He thinks this is an important distinction to make. How exactly do specialists monitor the underground activity under Yellowstone in order to be prepared to issue warnings in the event of a significant volcanic eruption? According to Poland, Yellowstone is extremely well monitored using a wide variety of methodologies. Both seismic activity and ground deformation are encompassed by this coverage. Although this is not an indicator of volcanic activity, but rather of the behavior of particular hydrothermal zones, we monitor the temperatures of various thermal structures. We take a look at the overall thermal emissions from space, collect gas and water to evaluate the chemistry over time, and monitor the flow of streams and rivers, as well as their chemical composition. What signs can there be that a catastrophic eruption is about to take place? As long as it was not an aftershock sequence following a tectonic event, Poland indicated that having hundreds of earthquakes in a short period of time with numerous felt events would be notable. This seismic activity would need to be accompanied by extremely significant ground deformation, tens of centimeters over the same short period, park-wide increases in geyser activity, and thermal gas emissions. It is common for the ground to rise and fall by 2 to 3 centimeters per year, and there are regularly around 2,000 earthquakes that occur each year in the region. Therefore, it would have to increase well above these normal background levels. Yellowstone is currently in a very stable state and has not exhibited any extraordinary seismic activity in recent times. But if the volcano were to erupt, and repercussions may be extremely severe. Volcanologists have indicated that the complication about which they are most concerned is wide-flung ash, which has the potential to cover an area that is 500 miles across with more than 4 inches of ash. The agriculture industry in the Midwest could be destroyed in the short term as a direct result of this, as well as a significant number of waterways, according to the predictions of several specialists. That's all we got for the video today. If you want to watch more such amazing videos, then don't forget to give a thumbs up to this one and subscribe to our channel. Thanks for watching.